All right, everybody, thank you so much for joining us. I am just keeping my eye on the clock. It is 1:30, so we would like to go ahead and get started. Thank you all for being here and joining us this afternoon. My name is Caroline Calhoun. I am a professional learning and attendance specialist at EdAdvance in Litchfield, one of the 6 RESCs that support CSDE and all sorts of work in the education space. So thank you so much for joining us for part 3 of this learning series focused on attendance and engagement. Just a couple logistics as we get started. If you wouldn't mind dropping your name in the chat, that would be helpful for us to know who's here. And along with that, if anyone else is in the room with you, sharing a computer perhaps in the space, that helps us to know who is attending these sessions. One other piece we wanted to let you know is, as we did last time, we will extend the session this afternoon into a little informal Q&A dialogue portion after our presentation is over. So if folks are feeling so inclined, you're welcome to stay on and chat with any of us in a smaller setting. We're happy to dialogue with you, bounce ideas around, and hopefully that will be useful for you. Thirdly, I really wanted to take a moment to recognize 2 people who have been instrumental in getting this e-learning series off the ground, in addition to our partners at AttendanceWorks. So Kari Sullivan Custer at the Connecticut State Department of Education and Francisco Baides at CREC have both been really key in working hard behind the scenes to get this up and running. So big thanks to both of them. And we also want you all to be aware that in spite of the fact that this session is the final one of the 3-part series, we want you to recognize that our support is not going away. We are not disappearing. Please feel free to reach out to any of us, to Kari, to Francisco, to me. This is our primary work, is really helping folks across the state with all things related to attendance and engagement. So please feel free to reach out. We'll make sure we add our contact info in the chat and in the follow-up email that Kari sends out with the slides from today's session. So we are poised to support you for whatever you might need in all things attendance related. So whether that's tech support, data analysis, big picture thinking, thought partnering, equity issues, it really all converges when we think about attendance. So please feel free to reach out to us for whatever you may need. In the same vein of our support is not going away, we wanted to make sure that folks are aware of a bi-weekly opportunity called Talk Tuesdays that the state puts on. This is an informal gathering on Zoom, and it's really just an hour-long attendance-focused discussion, and it includes all sorts of information, tools, resources, ideas, touching on all components of attendance and engagement. So we will drop that registration link in the chat as well so that folks who may not already be registered can go ahead and join us for those, but it's a great opportunity to hear what other districts are doing and get ideas for the work you're doing on the ground. So with that, thank you everybody very much for being here. I'm going to pass it over to Hedy, who is going to be leading you through today's work. If you haven't joined us before for the first 2 sessions, we are lucky to have Hedy Chang here, Executive Director from AttendanceWorks, Susan Lieberman, their Senior Fellow, and Ainika Williams, who is the Associate Director for Policy. So they will each be taking a component of today's presentation and sharing their expertise with you all. So thank you to our AttendanceWorks team for being here.
Great. I will just take a quick moment, and I'm actually going to turn it over to Ainika in a moment. But first of all, so glad to be all with all of you. As Susan said, if you are joining and you have other people with you in your room, please say that in the chat. Why don't we go to the next slide? Just a real quick overview. We've done these 3 sessions. The first one was on whole school engagement. The second one was on early intervention strategies and also using a team. The third one is on partnering to make a difference. And then let's go to the next slide. And if you want to see anything from the prior sessions, please take a look at the slides. You have all the links here, and this will, I think Kari's also been sending also the information to you. Ainika, I'm going to turn it over to you, and you can take it on from here with the introductions.
Yes, well, good afternoon, everyone. Next slide, please. So we'll go ahead and use the chat and share your name, your role, community, state, and a key partner for engaging students at your school. Okay, don't be shy. We're looking for intros. Okay, so we have Rebecca from DCF. Welcome, Rebecca. Okay. Erica and Chris, welcome. Okay, hello, Laura.
Nate, and again, if they've already introduced themselves, Anika, they could still offer up a key community partner.
Okay, welcome. There we go. Mary Jo, Karen, I think it's Karen Campbell, Fairfield, welcome. Okay, we'll continue to go ahead and drop your information in the chat. And it said our district are our key partners. Nice. Hi, Kari. Carrie from, okay. All right, so go ahead and again, keep dropping those introductions. Next slide, please. Okay, so afternoon pop quiz. Question one, early interventions begin when a student misses 20% of school. Is that true or false? And then question two, are there many factors affecting a student attendance? Three, schools must form a standalone attendance team. And four, you matter. We'll give it about 5 more seconds. Okay, it looks like we've got close to everyone. So for number one, it's false as stated. When we wait to intervene at 20%, students have missed a significant numbers of days. So we don't wanna let those absences add up. For number two, there are many factors affecting school attendance. That is true. So students miss school for many, many reasons. And I know we covered it on the second session. Number three is false. So while some schools do have standalone attendance teams, others find it better to integrate the work in an existing team such as MTSS or the PBIS team. And then number four, you matter. And that is always, always true. Okay. Next slide, please. Okay, so these are our goals for today. We will we'll talk all about partnerships, right? So partnerships in terms of not just teachers and admins, but we have community and agency partners to provide support and determine the difference that you are making in your schools. Next slide. Okay, in session two, we covered the first three functions of what attendance team does, and we looked at using your data to identify factors that affect school attendance. And then today we'll be looking at function four, which is mobilizing everyone in your school community to address attendance. And function five is to determine if you are making a difference in your school community as it relates to attendance. So those are the things that we'll be covering today. Next slide. Okay, so we're gonna go ahead and dive into the fourth team function. Next slide. So when we think about initiatives and programs to implement anything in schools, as educators, we generally think not another thing to add to a teacher's plate. But I always say it's not about doing more, it's about doing things differently. So when we talk about using a school community to affect change, we're not just talking about teachers and the admins, but we're talking about the secretary, the school bus driver, the local church, a local business. For example, I'm in Tallahassee, Florida, and one of our big partners for our school district is the Tallahassee Chamber of Commerce. And what they managed to do was to get every single kindergarten class at a Title I school adopted by a business. So we're talking money, we're talking about time, we're talking about mentors, right? So it goes back to that proverb, it takes a village to raise a child. And so when we're thinking about improving school attendance, it's the whole picture and not just our teachers in the classroom. And we strategically have students and families at the top because they are our nucleus. And of course we wanna support that we are creating solutions with students and families, and they're the center of everything that we do. So we have them strategically placed at the top. Okay, next slide. We're gonna show a short video. If you have any tissues, you may wanna hold it close because it's a tearjerker.
Hey, Mr. Q.
Did you see that? Why would somebody do that?
Please go into the classroom, no talking, quietly.
Hey, Miss Merida, how you doing?
We need you inside.
How do you think that makes us feel?
I forgot my number.
What's your name?
Jordan.
What's your last name?
Carter.
Go ahead.
School is hard enough.
Come on in, sit down quietly at your desks and begin writing.
This kind of stuff just makes it harder.
I said quietly, please. Who's talking? Is it you, Sophie? Don't let it be you.
Don't believe me?
Sophie.
Please just watch.
I'm not up here for me, I'm up here for you. Pay attention, okay? Now somebody answer me. Somebody needs to answer me really fast.
Every time we're ignored or yelled at, or silence, the teacher takes away what's possible.
No horseplay, no running, and especially no talking.
Moment by moment.
Ms. Garrity, your student's behavior yesterday in the lunchroom, it was terrible. Next time, silent lunch.
Did you hear that? Stay in line and catch a bubble. I'm not playing.
If this is education, we're in trouble.
Bye, Miss McGarrity.
Frederick Douglass said, once you learn to read, you'll be forever free. The way it is now, two of the three of us will never be able to really read. It doesn't have to be this way.
Hey, Jordan, how you doing?
Good.
Everyone we meet throughout our day can make a difference.
I've been waiting for you to arrive.
All the difference.
Good, how are you?
Good, how are you?
Great.
Hi. Hi, Jordan. Bye, Jason.
Good morning, Jordan.
How are you?
I'm doing well. Thanks for asking. How are you?
Good.
Go ahead and punch your number in.
Talk with us. Not at us.
That's okay. I'll look it up for you. Go ahead, sweetheart.
Okay.
All right.
Teach us what we need to know. That's how we get smarter.
Well, good morning, Sophie, Janicia, and Jordan.
And when you talk with us and teach us, give us bigger and bigger words.
Now what I'd like you to do, children, is turn around and converse with your neighbor and discuss where the mother might have gone.
Words that we can use to read and understand.
She is prey for eagles, so she hunts at night.
And that will take us places we can never reach without you.
Remember, we're entering the learning zone. Now, how can we show our respect to the children and teachers who are working?
We can walk quietly.
Yes. Okay, kids, so what I'd like you to do is continue writing your narrative, documenting your emotions, if you were the baby owl and your mother abandoned you in the nest.
What can you do? Learn all that you can so that you can challenge us to be our best.
You would have stayed and assisted them in whatever they needed.
Share yourself with us and show us how to share ourselves with others. Give us courage. Give us compassion. Help us find our own voices so we can become who we are meant to be.
Why would you want to silence us?
Next slide. So share your thoughts in the chat. I would like you all to share what's the connection between this video and attendance? And how are you encouraging everyone at your school to get involved in attendance and engagement? Again, based on the video, based on that we're looking at a full partnership beyond just the teachers and administration, how would you do that based on some of the things that we saw in the video? So relationships matter, absolutely. It's at the core of human relationships. So warm, encouraging welcome, connections matter. It's all about relationships. Thank you, Erica. Right, so that's the gist of it. At the core of everything, I mean, when we think about retention, we think about getting students in school, it's all about relationships is a key part with families and students. Every child needs a caring adult. Good. So that's the common thread that we see is that children need to feel connected to adults in the building. Very nice. Power of words and body language. Yes, absolutely. Next slide. And Hetty, back to you.
Great. So, you know, before we just shift, this next conversation is about involving all school staff and caring conversations. But I want to, folks in that last part mostly talked about the connection. I wonder if you might also offer a few strategies before we move into the next section about what are some of the things you're trying to get other folks involved in caring conversations? or not caring conversations, but in relationships, in building and supporting your attendance. Just helpful to have a little bit of that background before we move into the caring conversations part. Strategies that you're using? To get other staff members. Welcoming walks, morning meetings. So these are things that you're getting people to adopt. Relationship mapping. That's really helpful. I just think that it doesn't happen automatically that everyone else comes on board to do this work with you. That has to be intentional cultivation of that. And I really appreciate the comment that we talk with all staff about their interactions and how those make a difference. So now we're gonna talk about another strategy and tool that we can use. And this is really about caring conversations that we think have to be part of every single part of that tiered approach that we've been talking about. Whether that's your foundational supports and what everyone does as you're connecting in your tier one prevention, you know, and your early intervention and your tier three intervention. But how you think about doing this might vary depending on what you know about the levels of absenteeism. And let's go to the next slide. So it is important to understand, you know, that pyramid also corresponds to what we know about kids' attendance. So universal strategies are fine for the kids who have satisfactory attendance, but you might wanna know if a kid has at-risk attendance, because then you need even a little bit more personalization, more care. Then if you have moderate chronic absence between 10 to 19%, that is even more. And then severe or extreme chronic absence, where kids are literally missing more school than they're showing up. And let's go to a next slide. And so one thing you can do with kids in your schools is actually calculate kind of where they are. And a number of you in Connecticut actually now have data systems so that this is something you don't have to self-calculate. You probably have a dashboard at your school district that might be doing this for you, but it's really a percentage. So, you know, if you've had 100 days of school and you had 11 days, then that's an 11%. So a kid's moderately chronically absent. If you had 22 days, then that's a kid who's severe. By the way, for those of you know who Cecilia Leong on my team is, guess what she's a fan of? Yes, she is a Harry Potter fan. And so if you don't know Harry Potter and these names seem strange, then just find the book and you'll realize where this all comes from. But so let's say you had Voldemort who missed 63 days and you know they're in extreme levels. And just knowing these levels of absence and calculating them is really helpful for thinking about your strategies and how you have a conversation with families. So next slide. So this is now starting to translate those categories into thinking about how you tailor conversations. So if a kid's got satisfactory attendance, you know, that's a high five. Good going, Francisco. Hey, you're showing up to school every day. Keep it up. We want you to keep doing that. If you have them at an at-risk level, I might say, hey, Susan, I'm a little nervous, worried, you know, just is everything okay? Now, if you have chronic absence and a kid's missing 10% or more, I might say, just want to check in. Hey, Kari, notice you've missed a bit more, really want to figure out how to do this. And then if you're at a severe level, I might say, think about, you know, this is a pretty deep end level of severe levels of chronic absence. Maybe at that point, I might say to Anika, who's my school social worker, hey, Anika, could you join me for this conversation with Carolyn's family? Because I know you could help me. And then maybe we think about, we're gonna create a more private setting, or maybe do it, this as a home visit or a series of multiple visits, because we know that if there's severe chronic absence, that Carolyn and her family might be facing much more significant challenges. So again, knowing upfront where these challenges are, and some of you, as you're going, you can even think about integrating them, for example, into parent-teacher conferences, but think about how much you need to expand the time and the energy and the prep depending upon levels of absenteeism that they're seeing. Okay, next slide. So let's imagine we're looking at the kids who have chronic absence, either moderate or even severe or extreme, and you're gonna wanna have a conversation. You wanna think about how to have that conversation because there are sensitive things going on. I wanna now take you out of the world of attendance necessarily, but give you broadly the ability to reflect back and think about when you were about to have a conversation to broach a sensitive subject with someone. Take a moment and think about when the way you did it just didn't go so well. Created more defensiveness, made them angry at you, you didn't really have an honest conversation. And think about that situation. Doesn't always have to be about attendance, could be about attendance, could be about something else. And think about, why did that conversation go badly? And what could have helped to make sure that that conversation was more helpful, supportive, led to positive action? So please share in your chat. You could have been more empathetic. Often that is the case. We could be a little more empathetic. What else? Offered support. You know, what makes these go badly? There's misperceptions, a positive tone and empathy, right? That we don't come in with judgment, huh? That's part of the empathy. Not following up, not judging. Again, sometimes when we come in with blame, think about like the challenging conversations one has with one's spouse or partner. When we come in with blame, we all set ourselves up for conflict and tension. Asking why questions or asking too many why can make them defensive.
Hetty, Mandy wrote, focus on the positive and the solution.
Mm-hmm. Meeting people where they are. So we have a wealth of experience, I suspect, in this room, actually paying attention to how participants are seated. Yeah, absolutely. I think that connects to that when someone was talking about the body language, you know, a lot about how we physically orchestrate stuff sets the tone. Using you instead of we, the choice we have of language is really critical. So I want you to channel all these lessons learned, and then we're gonna sort of think about them in terms of attendance. And can we go to the next slide? So let's imagine, and I'm gonna have Dr. Williams here play the parent with me, though I will call her Anika, or Ms. Williams. So let's pretend I'm Alyssa's third grade teacher, and I'm gonna read what the situation here is. And then I'm going to have Anika, as Alyssa's parent, read what the situation is for her. So I've noticed that Alyssa seems more reserved and less attentive than normal in class. She's already missed 8 days in the last 2.5 months, and she's just tardy a lot. And, you know, she keeps saying she doesn't feel well, but I don't know, is she really seriously ill? And boy, I have been trying to reach Alyssa's mom and since the beginning of the year, and I've just failed despite multiple attempts. So.
And as Alyssa's parent, Alyssa has asthma, and that as mom is scared that she's been getting worse. Sometimes her wheezing keeps her up at night, so it's hard to get her to school on time. You are still worried that COVID could be a problem. She's starting to ask if she can stay home sometimes because she feels lost in class and does not want to look dumb in front of the other kids. You have not found that teachers at Alyssa's school know what it's like for you to try to manage Alyssa's asthma and make sure that she's all right.
So what if I came in, I said, Miss Williams, are you Alyssa's mom?
I am.
I am so glad I finally reached you. I have been trying to get hold of you all, you know, since the beginning of school. And I'm so concerned. Alyssa has already missed 8 days of school. We've only been in school 2.5 months. What is going on?
Well, Ms. Chang, yes, I'm Alyssa's mom. And first, let me say that I'm taken aback by your approach. There's a lot going on in our home with Alyssa's asthma, and we're trying to get it under control. I'm also trying to deal with her not wanting to come to school because she's so behind. And so rather than take the time to ask me what's going on or how you can help, I feel attacked. So I'm just going to step away from this conversation and maybe we can try again another time.
And that was maybe a diplomatic response on the part of Alyssa's mom in that case. What if I tried it on this approach instead? Are you Alyssa's mom?
Yes, I am. Is everything okay?
You know, first of all, I just want to say I am so grateful to finally meet you. I know it's been a crazy start of the year, and I normally love to, you know, connect with parents early on, and I'm so sorry so much time has passed, but I'm so grateful to get to know you. And before I say anything else, let me just say one thing. You have just raised a really special daughter.
Thank you.
You have a daughter who I notice when she is in class, she just is so empathetic. She notices the emotions of other kids. She's always seeing that. Nice job, Mom.
Thank you. I try. It's not easy, but I am trying.
So, and how's the beginning of the school year been for you all? I just know we haven't had any chance to connect.
Well, it's been rough. I don't know if you know, but Alyssa has asthma, and so it seems to progressively be getting worse. So we're trying to figure out how to manage that and get her in school, and I have to be at work. It's just so much going on, but there's some difficulty there.
Oh, I am so sorry to hear that. And clearly I think I need to know more so I can figure out how to support her, but I want to show you, this is a calendar of the days of school that have happened so far and the days that Alyssa's actually missed out. I just want to check, does that seem accurate? Do these seem like there's 8 days? Is your sense that Alyssa's missed this much school already?
Well, usually, you know, the way I see it, it's a day or two, but I guess since you're adding it all up, it does feel like a lot.
You know, I can only imagine how hard things must be with asthma. That can be just so frightening. And I know you must be really wanting to make sure that she's in a safe place with us here at school. I wanted to check in on these absences because when she's missing, there's been a number of key ideas around, you know, reading. We've covered these subjects, and I'm really noticing that Alyssa might be falling behind. So I want to work with you. I want to partner with you. How can we address your concerns about asthma? But I'm worried that if she continues to fall around, you know, that's the kind of thing that where kids then feel anxiety and don't want to show up to school. And I so don't want that to happen for Alyssa. Anyway, you guys get the gist. And if we go to the next slide, part of what we suggest is that we really need to think about a caring conversation. And this is actually developed by a teacher, a friend of a colleague of ours who used to teach in the school district where I live and who realized that she wasn't having much of a difference with parents because she said, like, we always start with inform. We start by telling people about, you know, attendance, or in her case, sometimes it was literacy. We don't start by building relations, starting about by learning, sharing. And because we don't, we actually almost don't, we sort of actually shoot ourselves in the foot, and we end up farther behind than when we were hoping to start with parents. And that what she found is if we could really think about our process of learn about a student's family, then share something special and positive, then inform, and then discuss, and then arrive at a plan, you're far more better. And depending on the set of challenges, this might not even be able to happen in just one meeting. You might have to build relationships. I keep thinking about your leap home visits, that's part of what you were doing was the leap home visits were helping with learn and share. And then later on, a couple visit in, you might be an informing. But we so often, when we're in a rush, we rush to inform and we forget to build in place the relationship building aspect. So if we go to the next slide, this kind of unpacks it. You can start with learn and share, and learning about a student's family and then sharing something positive. And I'd just be curious for the audience, you know, what are some questions that you've used to find out about a student's family, to kind of break the ice, to build that relationship? What are some of the kinds of questions that if you're starting to talk with a family that you can ask or that you've successfully used? What do you want for your children's child's education? What are your hopes and dreams? Yep. Sometimes we've even seen, and I think we did this actually with the LEAP home visiting training, we thought about different questions you could ask at different parts of the year. You know, how was your summer? But also, what was the favorite part of school? You know, so if school's been a place, what do you like most? And I really appreciate your comment, John. It's always asking an open-ended question, never a question that can be easily with a yes or no. It's kind of like when we talk to, you know, I was thinking of my kids, I say, and they always do the yes or no instead of giving more, something more example. And what's going well? What's going well? What's hard? What are your child's interests, passions, extracurriculars? Thank you, Carolyn. All right, so you start with learning, and then you're also always prepared with any kid to know enough about them to be able to say something positive. Every kid has something positive you can talk about. And if you haven't been working with that kid as well, then talk to the teacher or talk to someone who knows that kid. I think it's always helpful because it shows to a family that you cared enough to learn about a child and you really know something about their child. Next slide. So then after that, you want to inform. And we do find that having a calendar and showing, I actually remember this in New Britain years and years and years ago when we were doing work, and the principals had been actually able to get some real reductions in chronic absence. They talked about having calendars where they could mark down. And the other thing is with calendars is you might be able to notice patterns like, oh, this kid is always missing on a Friday or a Monday. And then you can ask what's going up on Fridays or Mondays. And then you can also make sure that you can connect back to what a kid might have missed during the days that they were gone. So that's part of the informing. So you're reviewing the attendance and you're also double checking that they think it's accurate. Next slide. And then you're discussing, you know, what do you know about what makes a kid want to show up to school? What might be the challenges that keep them from showing up to school? What would help to reduce absences, increase engagement? Are there things that you need to do to make sure they can make up for lost learning times, especially given that the past couple of years, kids have missed such extreme amounts of school? And then you can also encourage them to think about a help bank. So get a sense of what's their social support network. And maybe one of the things you're needing to do is help them meet other families so they have a stronger social support network. Next slide. And then the last thing is you're arriving at a plan. You're working with the family to identify particular steps that they can take, come up with that plan, agree upon what those can be, and even set up a time. When can we check in again to find out whether or not, how that's going on? Maybe something didn't work out the way you thought it would, or they were having trouble reaching out to a resource. But checking in also creates some accountability so everyone tries to take the steps that they said that they were gonna take. Last slide, next slide. So here's actually a worksheet that you can use to equip staff. I've also done things where I've equipped staff and we've actually encouraged them to take kids, actual real kids who are in these different bands, and then practice how they might talk to the family, because practicing those scenarios often helps to allow you to do it better when you do it in person. So let's go to the next slide. So this is where we get to go to small group discussions. We'd like you all to break up into small groups, to talk about who in your school community could benefit from learning about caring conversations, knowing that, you know, you want to have this happen for every kid and every family. And when and how could you introduce school staff to caring conversations? So we're going to give you 15 minutes when you're in your small groups. We'd like you to turn on your video camera, briefly introduce yourself, raise your hand to speak, ask clarifying questions, create space for everyone to speak. If you need to, use the chat. And the person whose first name is closest to the letter Z, you get to help make sure the conversation is moving and help facilitate. And I will say it's possible that some of us may pop in and out, those of us on the attendance works team. If we do, don't pay us too much attention. We're just trying to make sure that all of this is working smoothly. With that,
so one thing real quick, Hetty. So people do have the option to come back to the main session. There's a couple of folks who have just listed the name of the school or the district. So I don't know if that's a whole team of people or just one person. I put those folks just in one room in case it's a team of people. If it is indeed, if you're just one person and there's nobody else in your room, come back to the main session and I will put you in a room where there's other folks.
All right. So Francisco, you're going to generate, and people should join if they can. And if they if that doesn't work for you because you're actually in a big group, you can also come back, do something different, and you can always come back here and Francisco's going to stay here and be a resource and support for you. Susan, can we put the questions into the chat? Do you have that?
Yep, I can do that. Francisco, is that helpful? If I, I'll put it in, I'll broadcast it.
Yes, please do. If you could handle that, that'd be great. Thank you.
Hi, Francisco. This is Megan Boswell from New Milford Public Schools. There's no one in my room.
You were one of the ones I was talking about. So awesome.
No, there is thanks. Someone else who's usually doing this with me, but she just stepped out. So there's two of us here. We're not exactly a large group.
Okay, great. I'll send you somewhere else. Thanks. You should have, there we go, that worked. So everybody should be assigned to a room at this point.
All right, Francisco, do you need me to do anything else?
No, you should have also gotten the prompt to
go. Yeah, I
did.
I was just staying on if you need anything.
I'm
good. If you want to broadcast the question in another minute, just so in case people didn't catch both sides of the question.
Wait, say it again?
Do you want to broadcast it another 2 minutes just to remind people that there's two questions?
The impression I got.
Or do you want me to do that? Oh, hi, Jack.
If you could do that, that'd be great.
Great. Is that Jacqueline? Did you just came in?
Hi, this is Teresa Genevieve. I just joined. I'm sorry. I was stuck in a meeting.
That's okay.
All right, I'll get you to a room.
Could you move them? Thank you.
Yeah.
Appreciate it.
I'll handle all the moving folks around, Susan.
Okay.
Okay, and I'll broadcast the question again and then head into the room.
Great.
You might have one of my colleagues, Michelle Robles, joining in just a minute.
Okay. Cool. Jacqueline, do you need help getting into a room?
And are we discussing these two questions in the room? I'm sorry for my ignorance here.
Yes, it's the two questions that are on the screen.
Got it. Okay.
Sorry, I don't have your name. I just see on the screen it says T. Jen Grave. You should have been received an invitation to join room one.
Hi, yes. Yeah, so I already was on an old computer and was in group five. And I'm not able to use my camera and mic because the computer doesn't have that. So I was just wondering if you could just put me in the group.
Okay, you were in five. Let me see.
Yeah, we're like in there right now, yeah, but we're typing into the chat.
Yeah.
The desktop is old and doesn't have a computer, doesn't have a webcam or a microphone.
We have another question.
Okay, so let me assign. Okay, I see you as Burn J. I'm assuming
from Winthrop Elementary. I'm on the old computer. I can leave that one.
It's nice that you're all on board together.
Okay. And is there a particular room you're trying to get to? Because I'm not seeing you as unassigned here in the.
I can leave on my old computer if that's easier so that you can have this one joined.
Right now for a
school. Okay. Yes.
Oh, there you go. I'm going to move you back to room five.
Yep.
Yeah, please.
Okay, great. There you go.
Thank you.
And I still have not received an invitation to join a room. I'm sorry.
Okay. I see you. I'm going to move you to another room. Let's see. There you go. This says you received an invitation to join room two. Excellent.
Got it.
All right, folks should be coming back as we speak.
All right, thanks so much. And even as you're coming back, if you, can we go to the next slide, Francisco? If you might share in the chat any ideas that you came up about when and how you could equip others to, in your school community to have caring conversations, that would be great. So any thoughts, or maybe folks have tried equipping others in their community to have caring conversations and at work? We'd really love to just hear any thoughts, ideas, strategies that you've used.
I think a lot of us are parents, right? We have kids in schools.
So coming from that perspective, as a parent yourself, I often find that, especially from one mom to another, you know, it kind of alleviates the school versus parent idea, I think, when parents come to schools, they're a little defensive. So that's like my major thing. My major thing is, how can I let these families know, or moms or dads know, I'm human just like you. I may go through some similar things, you know, with my kids. And so when you approach it from a parent to parent perspective, I've had a lot of success with that.
That's fabulous. Really good advice. Any other thoughts about how you might be able to use this as part of equipping other folks in your school community to take on these caring conversations? And you know what? I think we'll keep going. We'll have plenty of ideas to think about how do we engage in this respectful approach to relationship building. So, Anika, turning back over to you.
Thanks, Hetty. So as we talk about deepening our relationships with families, I want us to just take a step back and I guess remove ourselves from the educational context for 1 second. And just think about our everyday interactions with people, strangers, people that we meet. Imagine you're at a restaurant. So I'm going to use this restaurant analogy to explain this concept. And you've just ordered an $80 steak, and you ordered your steak to be cooked medium. When they bring out the steak is a brick, right? It's well done. You can't cut into it. I think most of us on the call would be frustrated, annoyed, disappointed, or if you're like me, you might be hangry, right? Hungry and angry at the same time. And so immediately, most of us would say, I need to speak to a manager. I need to speak to someone with some kind of decision-making because I'm paying $80 for a steak and it's not cooked to my standard, right? That's the first part of that pie, which says needs identified. We need somebody to hear our frustration and get this rectified. Our expectation is that the manager will then come out, offer an apology, offer to cook another steak, and then maybe even comp dessert. And so we will go from like 100 to maybe down to 25. Why? Because we have received immediate help. There was an explanation about what happened, and we have next steps. So we know we're going to get a steak. It's going to come out the way we want it. And once they have delivered on their promise and you get your medium cooked steak and you enjoyed your dessert, you're going to say, well, I'll be back. I'm going to come back to this restaurant, because you'd now then trust, that's the more trusting relationship piece, that when you come back, that they're going to take care of you, regardless of what's going on in the restaurant, whether the other complaints is going on, that manager, that waiter or waitress is going to take care of you. And not only are you going to come back, but you're going to bring a friend, or you might bring your mom when she comes into town. So that's that deeper sense of partnership. And so I love to use this analogy because sometimes we think of these concepts as very abstract and philosophical, and it's really quite simple. And many of us are experts, obviously, in this, whether we are walking through the doors of a ritzy restaurant or we're going to Outback, our parents want to feel the same level of service when they come through the doors, regardless of what's going on in the building. So again, wanted to just use that analogy for relationship building. And the next slide talks a little bit more about this on a school context. So if you can hit play, we'll watch that.
As educators, so many times parents call and they're on 10 and we're on 4. And so what happens, parents are so upset and we really don't have the time to have that conversation. So I think it's important to be able to say to a parent, you know, I can tell that you really need my attention. And right now, I don't feel I can give you my undivided attention. And what you're saying to me is so important that I would like to schedule a time where I can hear you, listen, and we can talk. I think those are also examples of where communication becomes broken when we are so busy running the school and taking care of school business, we forget that the parents are our business. And we have to take a step back and pause and realize that this parent has had an experience that hasn't been favorable. And so we owe them the opportunity to be heard, to be understood, and to do it with empathy, and do it in a way that maintains their dignity and respect. So, you know, those three parts to active listening: one is just to listen and take notes, And the other is to, you know, make sure that you recall what you heard and ask for clarifying questions. And those conversations take time. That's not something that you can just pick up the phone and answer and guarantee that you can walk through the stages of actively listening. It's something that has, sometimes it requires a planned conversation.
Anika, you're muted.
Thanks, Eddie. So in the chat, what might cause the cycle to break down in communicating with your parents, and what can school teams do to keep it going? So considering the pie, considering the both analogies from Lori and I, what sometimes caused that cycle to break down? And we're all guilty of it. I've been in the classroom, I've been a school counselor, I've been really busy and I can't talk to a parent. So I've definitely been there. So what do you all do? Like, what causes these breakdowns? I love that. Disney level family engagement. I really, really like that. Anyone else? What can school teams do to keep the cycle going of care, of having these caring conversations? What does that look like at a school level, at a district level? Okay, so you need to have the cycle first. Absolutely. So it's starting, it's hitting go and ensuring that you're responsive to emails and phone calls in a timely fashion. Anything else? Okay, next slide. Susan, I believe this is you.
This is. Thank you, Anika. And I always appreciate that analogy you create. So next, we're going to be talking about mobilizing the community and engaging community partners. It's clear that schools cannot do this work alone. And the second part of mobilizing the community is identifying and engaging those partners. So we're going to do another poll. It's kind of like a self-assessment of your school. In community partners and public agencies are partners in providing support to students and families in my school. Is it an urgent gap? We really don't have anybody. Needs improvement? We only turn to businesses once a year because we need their those gift cards or measurable progress. We have people coming in and we'd like to build at that more or strongly in place. So just put, where do you think your schools are in this poll? So it looks almost, people are still putting their responses in. A few strongly in place, but most see that it needs improvement, that we need to reach out a little bit more. All right. And it looks like 68% see it needs improvement. Well, that's what we're going to talk about now, is how can we reach out to these community schools? All right, next slide. Thank you for participating in the poll. Here's a video that I want to share. That's all right. You can continue on.
When I first came here, it was very welcoming. It was like an open door, like they kind of pull you in. I didn't feel like the principal was too busy to speak to me. I didn't feel uncomfortable.
Being a community school, it's like a one-stop shop here. So parents, the community, they come into this school, all the resources are in one spot.
Having 48% of students in temporary housing, having 32% of students with disabilities, having 28% of English language learners, it's a difficult challenge. Taking all of those components to now go into the classroom to get them socially, emotionally stable to then produce the academic.
One thing that I really appreciate about this school and the staff that's here are that they're really looking out for the community. Children come from a variety of backgrounds, come from you know, trauma situations. They come to our school, they're looking for somewhere where they can just come here and learn. Our school does a great job of providing a safe space for children.
Families who used to live across the street in temporary housing have gotten permanent home, and they're now in Brooklyn, Far Rockaway, and they still choose to come to 188. Makes a difference. That means that we're doing something right. We provide the washing machine. We have a schedule that we have some parents that volunteer. They come and they do the laundry here during the week or Saturdays. Something else that we definitely do here is provide the mental health services, not just for the children, but for the families.
So if a parent needs legal service, we're able to provide them legal services with some of our partner agencies. If they need a GED, we're able to assist them with that. And ESL classes, nutrition education, these are some of the things that our school provides.
Actually, this year we have improved attendance a lot. And one of the things that I feel that helps with the attendance, when they feel comfortable with the work that you do in class, doing a lot of hands-on activity, it makes them come to school on time.
They want you to succeed. And I think they do a great job.
Thank you. So what this video for me, it talks about community schools and how they use partners, but I think it's a really important reminder and opportunity to think about how different schools can coordinate with community partners and what that means for students and families. So here's a slide. We know that the greater the size of the issue, the greater the problem of attendance, and the more we need to access our partners. So here, there's many potential partners that you can use. And here's a list of different types of partners that you might be able to use. So, and we need to be creative and think of one partnership that you can possibly strengthen, as well as one potentially new partner to bring in. And businesses, think of businesses more than just somebody who can give you a gift card. They could become mentors. They can help give students powerful work experiences and mentoring relationships. There's an example of a larger business in one community where they were able to provide support to two different groups. One was to a group of elementary students where they actually bus the students there, but the adults could easily go back to the school, and they became literacy partners. So what a mentor would do is they would just read a book together with the student. And it was an activity that they could do, but it was actually an individual that they looked forward to seeing once a week. In another example of a high school, there was a business that had a lot of what I would call math geeks. They were actuaries and accountants, and they worked out a situation so that 10 people volunteered to go to the school once every other week and to be a math tutor. And this was just a commitment for once a semester. And it was such a wonderful opportunity for these students because they had somebody who was working with math, who was excited about the math, that actually provided that tutoring services. And it also was somebody outside of their school that they had a connection to. So it was really important. There's all sorts of opportunities. Next slide. And in this next slide, you can see that there's places you can go to look for resources. United Way has this wonderful 211 service. If you haven't tried that, there's also an online search called findhelp.org, really a great resource if you want to see potential opportunities. And there's also a Connecticut resource on educational safety, mental health, and food insecurity resources. And that link will come to you after this session. So and think of any other examples, but here's a chance for you to use the resources. And some of you maybe have developed something just within your community. Next slide. The other thing is to align the partners and think about what is it that you're addressing? What is the problem that comes up here? For example, something that comes up frequently, it can be work family responsibilities. There was a student, a high school student, who was often late to school. And people tried to talk to him about this problem. They tried to write letters to the parent, and the parent never responded about the problem. And it wasn't until the student actually had a connection with somebody that he admitted he comes late to school every day because he's getting his siblings ready for elementary school, and the elementary school starts after the high school does. So here he was taking this responsibility, and he was working with them, trying to get them to school, and he was late. And it wasn't until they realized what the actual problem was that they were actually able to figure out before and after care for this student. And that made all the difference. But he didn't want to tell anybody because he didn't want to get his mother in trouble, who was working two jobs. He didn't want to get his siblings in trouble. So he was very protective. So it's really trying to find that root cause and aligning the intervention. Next slide, please. So think about who you're partners are. Here's a great tool. You can just list who the partners are and figure out how you can potentially use them. And this is something you can do as a team. Next slide. All right, now we go on to the next area, the next function of a team, which is determining if you are making progress. Next slide. When teams take stock of their efforts, they really need to look at these four questions. So let me use this as an example. They decide to have positive call, teachers make positive call home to every student. So if you're looking at this and looking at these four questions, you could say, how much did we do? Well, we wanted all teachers in our schools to make one positive call or one positive contact with every teacher. And you could say, how much did we do? Well, in this first month of school, first time we did it, we had half the teachers respond. How well did we do it? Well, just half the teachers did it. What difference did we make for students who received support? Well, we noticed that the parents seemed to be communicating more with those teachers who had made those calls. And there seems to be a slightly higher increase in the attendance. Then you ask this other question, what was the impact on the school as a whole? You could find out, well, other teachers are not thinking about contacting families because their colleagues had a positive experience. By asking these four questions, you really learn, are these strategies that we're implementing, are they making a difference? Are we, you know, take a stock, does it need to be tweaked? Next slide. The next way, another way to look at monitoring your progress and how to proceed is by using the Plan, Do, Study, Act. Some of you may be familiar. It's also referred to as PDSA. And what that is, it's an iterative four-stage problem-solving model. And it's used for improving a process or carrying out some kind of change that you want to bring forward. So what you want to do is first assess your current system. Is it working? Analyze what are the root causes? What are the what do you think are the barriers? Choose an attendance improvement strategy. Then you implement the attendance to the strategy. And then you take a step back and measure those outcomes. Study it. Analyze your results, and then act, revise and refine. Because with everything that you do, whether you're looking at a new reading program, math program, attendance strategy, we often need to take a step back and just tweak what we're doing. Next slide. So here's an example of a strategy that you might want to, that you could do with a PDSA, Plan, Do, Study, Act model. You want to introduce lunch buddies, and the goal is to improve attendance for disconnected students. And the change that's being tested is if you have this, and counselors will invite students feel disconnected, and they'll meet with them in person every Friday. And the driver is developing these positive peer relationships. And your goal is to actually approach those students who are missing 10 to 19% of school. And you're hoping that they're going to feel more connected, have better outcomes, attend more, and maybe select some students who have total absences And you're going to look to see if these are students that often have absences on Fridays. So you're going to ask questions. You're going to try to study it. Are counselors willing to support this? Which students will show up? Does the attendance improve? And is there a spillover? Does it improve attendance afterwards? Next slide. So by following this model, you're actually going to plan it, work on some of the details. You know, you have to recruit the counselors, you select a place to have the lunch, maybe add some conversation starters, have a special outreach to those students who are chronically absent, and note whether the students attended after each session, you know, if they're attending more. So you make some predictions about what's going to happen and then look at the data you're going to collect. And then you actually implement it. And then you want to study what happened. Well, it worked, except one of the counselors was sick. So, and you realize, we didn't have everybody there. Of all the students who were invited, half showed up. All right, well, that's a good start, but what do you need to do? And you realize, oh, we forgot to put a special outreach for those students who are chronically absent. But you notice that some students who were typically absent on Friday were there. Next slide. And then you figure out, what do you need to do to adapt? What do you need to change what you're doing? So you might decide that you need a substitute. So if the school counselor is absent, you have somebody who's standing by that's ready to jump in when you need them. Ask students who attended to invite a friend. How are we going to build those positive peers? So it's really a process in which you can look at this strategy and then figure out, are you monitoring it and figure out, is it working? What do you need? Often the first time we implement a strategy, it doesn't work perfectly. Take stock and figure out how to tweak it. That's what we teach our students to do, and that's what we need to do. And so it's just a chance to really think about and honor what you're doing and take into account. So before we end this, I just want to honor all the work that you're doing. And I'm going to share a little story that I think I just want to, a personal story that I want to share with you folks. And it's about my kids. They gave me permission. They're in their 20s, so they're okay. But one's an introvert and one's an extrovert. So I just want to say that when you go out and you say, greet everybody in the morning, or you're greeting kids in the hallway, if you say, good morning, everyone, my daughter, who's an extrovert, will naturally assume you're talking to her. Even though you say, good morning, everyone, she just assumes you're talking about her. My daughter, who's the introvert, if you say, good morning, everyone, she will assume you're talking about somebody else and not her. And when you walk down the hallway and you see my daughter, who's the extrovert, she will give you back everything that you want. She will respond, she'll ask you questions, you'll have a delightful conversation. My daughter, particularly in elementary school, who is the introvert, she's walking down the hall. Most likely she will not respond to any question that you ask. She won't necessarily give you back anything you think. But I want to just share with you that when she came home, she will tell us everybody who said hello to her. She will tell us the questions you ask. I'll even say, did you respond? She'll say no. But she'll say, what a nice person. They reached out to me. And she'll talk about that. So I just want to honor everything that you do every day. Even though students may not respond immediately back to you, just remember, they hear you and they appreciate what you're doing. So I just want to thank you for everything that you do every day. It does make a difference. So now we want to, next slide. Now we want to leave time for you to ask any questions that you may have, things that you heard today, things that, you know, struck a chord. You can just feel free to just put it in the chat, or you can unmute anything you want to say.
Susan, I'm going to suggest that speaking of people with different levels of comfort, why don't we stop the recording? And this is just those of you who came, you know, have either things that you're doing that you want to share with others, or things that were